Commodities themselves may not endure, but their transport is the cause of cultural, linguistic, gastronomic, architectural, and artistic migrations. It's through these migrations that trade's legacy comes down to us. The traditional cheese of Bordeaux, for instance, was till very recently Dutch, Edam or Gouda. Such exchanges are not necessarily partial or fair. Even in an association of supposed equals, one partner will be dominant. For about 300 years, from 1250 to 1550, Lübeck was the capital of Northern Europe. A de facto capital, that is. Officially, it was just one of many city-states. But its mercantile power was unmatched. And that power is graphically demonstrated in the city itself. The early years of its preeminence coincided with the arrival of the Gothic from northern France. The template had evidently been altered en route. This is the idiom arrived at in Lübeck's diocesan cathedral. It's vast, it's magnificent, but it was built on the periphery of the city. The contemporary city church, the Marienkirche, is equally vast, equally magnificent. And it's central, it's attached to the town hall. It was one of six such churches built by wealthy merchants. It might be a sacred structure, but it's not entirely useless. The other 6 days of the week, it was used as a corn exchange and as a market. It showed where the power in Lübeck resided, and it did not reside with the cathedral and with the bishop. Merchants also built dwellings for themselves and for their employees, and docks, and almshouses, and warehouses, prisons, fortresses. Brick and stepped gables, crow-step gables, are everywhere. Brick, because there was little building stone that would withstand the weather, and decorative gables because, well, because one day a mason thought of it, others liked the result, and it caught on. It crossed the seas. A shaped gable has no structural purpose. Its purpose is to appeal to the eye, to make a grand silhouette against the northern sky, to allow both patron and craftsman to show off. It is then purely ornamental. It was occasionally used in such buildings as warehouses and fortresses. It was frequently used in houses, which were also workplaces. It's associated with brick architecture, but it's not peculiar to it. Think of the similar gables fashioned from harl and granite in the east of Scotland. Brick is pliable, versatile. It does not constrain the designers who use it. Their decisions are aesthetically based. So the predominant characteristics of northern architecture are deliberately willed. Precise, lugubrious, stern, morbidly fantastical, exhilaratingly gloomy, pompous, worldly, industrious. These qualities are not the products of chance. They indicate how the North projected and glorified itself, how it saw itself, has continuously seen itself, still sees itself. Lübeck's mercantile power was translated into legal power, hence the city's adopted Lübeck law. It was also translated into aesthetic power. And Lübeck's language, Plattdeutsch, the German of the flat coastal plains, became the lingua franca of the Hansa. The Hansa lasted 300 years, as long as the British Empire, longer than the French Empire, longer than the Belgian Empire, longer than the Soviet Empire, much longer than the 12 years of the Thousand Year Reich. Both those tyrannies occupied Hansa territories and built prolifically. Yet their architectural legacy does not begin to compare with that of the Hansa. Neither in terms of beauty, which is obvious, nor in terms of sheer quantity. These cities possess an identity that is collective and corporatist. They affected globalization when the globe was not yet a globe. They wear an imperial uniform. Despite having created a homogeneous culture, the Hansa is overlooked as an empire because it was rooted in trade rather than in the desire to impose a toxic religion or noxious ideology on people who didn't want it. It wasn't in the business of coercion. It wasn't in the business of capturing hearts and minds. The only parts of the body that interested it were the pocket and the purse. Its only significant belief was in the creation of wealth and the communal benefits that derived from wealth. There were no murderous emperors, no tinpot caliphs, no lethal autocrats, no self-aggrandizing prefects setting the world to rights. It was a bourgeois, collectively organized proto-liberal confederacy, which in pursuit of its commercial self-interest resisted the church and the often jealous aristocracy, the blood-determined, dynastic, tribal hierarchy of electors, grand dukes, landgraves, margraves, and so on. The Hansa was itself cannily pacific. It preferred diplomacy and economic sanctions to belligerence. It took to arms with reluctance and then only in self-defense. War not only interrupts trade, it's costly. It wastes revenues that might be better spent in the exercise of civic consolidation, in the construction of better cities, in the pursuit of comfort. Still, in what would become the dubious tradition of neutral states, the Hansa was happy to ship weapons. Other people's wars were profitable. Hansa cities suffered Nazism as a form of internal colonization. That, anyway, is the myth that has been created. Many subsequently found themselves under the yoke of the Soviet Empire for almost half a century. Yet another era then to be eradicated by resort to a prouder past. The Hansa was the best thing that ever happened to these cities. It was what made them. Hitler loathed the Hansa cities in general because they were born of pragmatic materialism and internationalism and were thus deemed un-German. He especially loathed Lübeck because it had forbidden him to canvass there in the 1933 election campaign. The Hansa cities and the GDR were further prohibited from proclaiming their identity under communism, which sought to expunge regional distinctions.
From anywhere, but especially from here, out on the Sound, Hansestad Stralsund has most heartbreakingly beautiful skyline. Is this the Venice of the North?
T. Dan Smith wanted to make Newcastle the Venice of the North. Other Venices of the North are Bruges, Aalborg, Amsterdam, Birmingham, Manchester, the Maryhill area of Glasgow, Mackenzietown in Inverness. But why should Venice be the measure, the standard? Because it's in the south, which rules our brain because of the PR that travellers have done on its behalf. The number of books devoted to Venice in the past 60 years is 700. The number of books devoted to the Hansa cities is 70.